episode of Dirty Laundry, and today I'm interviewing Robert Bean from Black Rebel Motorcycle Club.
You cannot fight it, all the world denies it. Open up your eyelids, let your demons run.
I changed my name to Robert Turner, which was the name of this movie performance. Mick Jagger in the 60s. I really loved. I watched far too many times, but that wasn't why. My father, Mike Bean, he was well known enough within the music industry, and he had a name for himself. Kids don't know him, but like rock journalists knew him. At least when our first album came out, and I didn't have a name yet, really to speak of. And I just wanted to dodge the father-son thing of being like in the shadow, and I wanted to make it on my own, you know, everyone kind of does. And so I just thought, well, that's an easy fix, just call myself something else. And I did, until Howl came out, and by that point, I was such a bigger star than he was that, now I eclipse him, so it's the way it should be. I liked my name. I liked, like, my birth name. And my middle name is Levon from godfather of mine? Levon Helm from the band. And my dad played with them for a while. He played, once Robbie Robertson left, played guitar for the band, and they were around when I was a kid, and like, the truth is I hated their music when I was a kid, because it was the music my dad liked, and he was so passionate about them, and so I just wanted to not like whatever he liked. And then now, like, when I think you need to be older to appreciate the band and what they do. They're not for rookies, but and by that time I was really proud of my name and the fact that you know Levon was a part of that. And,
I'm a nail, I'm a knife, I'm a preacher with a gun, I'm a one man lie, I'm a king, I'm a ruse, I'm born again, but
did you spend much of your childhood on the road with your dad? At what point in the Calls career were you a young lad?
Through the birth, I guess, or maybe, I don't know when they began. But I just remember when I was growing up, he was always on the road, and he'd take me out on summer through school. So my summer was spent usually on the road with him in hotel rooms and buses and, well, Winnebago's actually, before they had buses. And it was cool. Like, I thought, when you're a kid, a hotel room's like the most funnest, yeah, exotic. You can, any TV thing you want and any food, you call somebody up and you can make a mess and they'll clean it up the next day. So I think I fell in love with hotels before I fell in love with rock and roll music. But also just being a kid and having an all-access pass is the best feeling in the world, because when you're little, you always get told where you can't go, and it was the first time I was able to walk in front of a line of adults and be like, see, and then I could get in. And I did that quite a few times. Even when I didn't have to go back in, I'd go back in again just to show them I could.
So Michael tours with you now as your sound man. So what is it like having your... What are the good things and bad things about having your father on the road with you all the time?
Getting to tell him what to do.
Getting to cut his paycheck? Strange dynamic?
It is strange. It was stranger before. I was more like a bit weird about it, and I didn't know how I felt. I was, your first rock and roll tour out, you don't want your dad around, for the most part, seeing what he shouldn't be seeing. But, so I was... he didn't come on the first one, actually, so technically I got to.
One tour.
Yeah, I had one to let it all out. And then we came around near the beginning of the second album, I think. Or the end of the first. We had such hard times with sound people that they were driving us nuts, and we were driving them nuts. Like, we had major blowouts, but they stormed off. And so... he'd never done live sound, but we knew, you know, he's a great producer, and so we asked him, would you cover us for, you know, just one tour, that was all it was supposed to be. And he was like, no, I don't know what I'm doing. And he came, and he was amazing, he was really great, and it was the best we'd ever sound. And then he liked it. He took, he got into the craft and learning it, and he's, you know, one of the greatest sound people I think there is touring, and other people are, you know, trying to steal him, which is cool.
So you and Pete first met early on in high school, right?
I was a sophomore, he was a junior.
What was Pete like in high school?
I don't know. Okay.
The public rated version.
He was the guy at school that had an acoustic guitar every day, and he played in the back of the school. He was kind of the hippie guy. He hung out with the hippies that were in the back with the hacky sack and smoking whatever. But he wasn't quite part of their thing. And he was good with the girls, but he wasn't quite popular. He was kind of the rogue guy that you date when you're trying to piss off the jock, I guess. And which is how I met him first, was there was a girl I liked, and then I found him trying to teach her this guitar on acoustic, or trying to teach her a Jimi Hendrix song on acoustic guitar, and I was like, you asshole. And because I, you know, thought I had that in the bag. So I guess, yeah, that was Fighting Over a Girl. Tap Again, probably be how it ends.